someone else wants to do that.
Okay, bismillah, assalamu alaikum. We're going to start. Go ahead and start, inshallah. There are a couple of questions coming from people. First of all, about the book itself, Badak al-Jasir. You have this book available on Amazon. You have it available on awakeningusa.com, the publisher. And Dr. Jasir actually is going to have meet the author in ISNA. So September 1st, in the ISNA convention, he's going to have meet the author from 4 to 6 for this particular book. So you can go there, of course you can have a lot of copies, you can get it from there, inshallah. You can even do book signing, inshallah, as well, right? So September 1st, inshallah. So this is with regards to the book. Other books for Dr. Jasir as well, the English copies are available on Amazon. You're going to find a lot of his books on Amazon for the English copies. For those who are asking about the Arabic copy of this book as well, the Arabic copy is on Dr. Jasir's website. He has a full copy on his website, so you can go there. I guess it's a PDF document, so you can download this if you're interested in the Arabic text. I'll put his website, inshallah, on the... Okay, final word. A couple of people also asked me about the other lectures that we had and the other classes that we had, including this one, and having a video for it. We will, inshallah, publish it as soon as we can. We need to work on editing it, and most likely we're going to have it on Qurtuba's YouTube channel, Dr. Jasir's YouTube channel, and hopefully we might be thinking of getting maybe a DVD out of it or something, and for people who are interested. So for all three lectures, inshallah. So we are working on it. I don't want to give you the exact time because I'm not sure people are working on it, what time you're going to finish it, but inshallah you're going to have it available.
If you type this, inshallah, if you go to my website, you will see links on the web. You can email, inshallah. Facebook, Twitter, MySpace, YouTube, as well, on the channel. Like any way of communication, inshallah, is open anywhere after this session. Please feel free to communicate. I have this at hotmail.com and at Gmail, but the Gmail is in the Facebook, it's all for the admins. But at hotmail.com, this is my website, my email as well. And sometimes an admin will answer you if you are on some of this, but you know, inshallah. I'm not very active on Twitter, but I'll start to just put some updates, but not very active. Inshallah. Alhamdulillah, salatu wasalamu ala Rasulullah. The next step, the Shaykh is talking about as-suhba saliha, good friends. He's talking about good friends, the importance of good friends. As a step towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's saying, لا تصحب من لا يهذك حال ولا يدلك على الله مقال. Do not befriend someone who does not elevate you with his or her state, or guide you to God with his or her speech. So here he's talking about two things, about speech and about state. Al-hal is another Sufi terminology where we are talking about not the state of the mind, but the state of the art, of the heart. The state of the heart is actually the hal. And that hal is also something that you find in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The companion who came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and told him that when we are with you, we see heaven and hell as if we can see them, as if we are in the hereafter. So when we go back home, we have a different hal, we have a different state of heart. So he told him, sa'atun wa sa'a, 1 hour for this and 1 hour for that. So Hudayfa, I think. So the companions had this feeling of the hal. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would convey that state of the heart to them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's very important in the journey, he is saying, to befriend somebody with a good state of the heart. Not with a heart that is full of envy or full of lust, or full of a heart that is pure as possible, and that is pushing its person towards excellence. He said, "ولا يدلك على الله مقال." Or at least, the person, if with, if not a good heart, at least a good tongue. You know, at least something that the person could tell you that informs you. But, and then he's saying that there is a wisdom behind that, behind having good friends. ربما كنت مسيئا فأراك الإحسان منك صحبتك من هو أسوأ حالا منك. He's saying it would be that you are doing evil, yet you think that you are doing good because you're comparing yourself to your friend who is worse than you. So he's saying that when you have friends who are worse than you, you say, well, I'm good. I'm praying at least. See, all my friends are not praying. I'm praying. You know, all my friends drink, but I'm not drinking. I'm this kind of thing. So, and then you feel that you are an angel just because you don't drink alcohol, just because all your friends drink, for example. But he is saying, don't compare yourself like that. Don't compare yourself to somebody who is doing a mistake. And they might be good in many other things, but you don't compare yourself to them. They might be drinking, but they are generous, for example. You don't compare yourself to that. You look at their faults only. So he's saying, no, look at somebody whose heart is conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and his state of heart is very high, so that when you compare yourself to somebody who is higher than you, then you compare yourself to somebody who is high. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is saying, مثل الجليس الصالح والجليس السوء, you know, the famous hadith, the person who is a good friend and a bad friend.
How would you tafriq baina muqarim wa hal? What I understand is that he's on a journey towards closeness to Allah,
yeah,
which is a muqam. And then one can go through different ahwal or states during that journey. And sohbah of good companionship, comparison needs to be someone who's of, and this is where my question is of higher hal or muqam? I guess muqam.
I don't know. I don't know how you differentiate between maqam and hal.
Okay.
Like status and state of the heart. I really don't know. So I was saying that a good friend and a bad friend, the Prophet ﷺ is saying, a good friend and a bad friend are like a perfume seller and a blacksmith. A perfume seller might give you some perfume as a gift, or you might buy some from him, or at least you might smell its fragrance. While a blacksmith, he might burn your clothes, or at the very least, you would breathe the fumes of his furnace. So in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ is teaching us that even if that person is just a friend, but he has a very, very low state of the heart, then you might see something that you don't like, you might smell something that you don't like, and so forth. So you need to, and this does not contradict, by the way, it does not contradict from having friends who are not Muslim, which is Islamically, that there's no problem with, you have a friend. The issue of awliya in the Quran is a friend and a supporter in a war. That's different. You know, لا تتخذوا الكافرين أولياء من دون المؤمنين أتريدون أن تجعلوا الله عليكم سلطانا مبينا, and so forth. The ayat that talks about awliya are supporters in a state of conflict and so forth. But just to have a friend who is not Muslim, but even the friend who is not Muslim, you need to choose that friend, because there are friends who are not Muslim who would give you bad good words, and who would show you good deeds, not necessarily talk to you about Allah, some would as well, but not necessarily talk to you about Allah, but, you know, lead you to some good cause, or they are good parents and you know, teach you something about the children, etc. Like, or a good neighbor who is protecting you while you're away, or protecting your family, etc. Like, so a good friend is a friend, whether Muslim or non-Muslim. But the Sheikh is talking about a suhbah is more than just a friend. Suhbah is companionship in the journey. So la tashab, he's saying in the rihla, you know, in the journey, you cannot take a companion in your journey who is too far from these standards. Because that is different. That's a different story. Even though I know that in the Sharia, a Muslim man could marry a Muslim woman and so on. And she's not Muslim, and she's his wife, the closest person to her. But also, not any Christian would be right to marry in that sense. and not any, and so forth. Like the person, even if the person is not a believer, there are certain ethical standards, moral standards that the person has to have. Not because that Muslim man is allowed to marry a non-Muslim girl, then he goes and marries the worst possible non-Muslim girl. That is a disaster. Whether she's Muslim or not Muslim for that matter, but that is the issue, that the moral standards here are important. But in your journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't befriend, don't take as a companion somebody who does not alleviate you, because that is very important. And this alleviation is very important. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had also alleviated the state of his companions with a word, with educating them. So their sohbah, their companionship to him, was something that alleviated them, because they saw the example of the best possible example of a heart. So that alleviated their hearts. The companion said, many of them, the Prophet ﷺ died, and the next morning, he is saying, "Ankarna qulubana." We didn't recognize our hearts, because their hearts were so connected to his, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his heart was alleviating their hearts, you see. So the hearts are connected. It's very important to know that the companions or the companionship has an effect on your heart, and whomever is close to you affects your heart. Then he's talking about dhikr, which is also a very important step upwards and a step forward, which is not to quit dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not stop mentioning God, he's saying. And that is very important. And the question, obviously, that he was asked, okay, what if I don't, my heart is not present? What if I don't feel the remembrance of Allah? Should I stop or should I continue? So he's saying, لا تترك الذكرى لعدم حضورك مع الله فيه لأن غفلتك عن وجود ذكري أشد من غفلتك في وجود ذكري. I read to the end and then translate. فعسى أن يرفعك من ذكر مع وجود غفلة إلى ذكر مع وجود حضور ومن ذكر مع وجود من ذكر مع وجود غفلة إلى ذكر مع وجود يقظة ومن ذكر مع وجود يقظة إلى ذكر مع وجود حضور ومن ذكر مع وجود حضور إلى ذكر مع وجود غيبة أو غيبة عما سوى المذكور وما ذلك على الله بعزيز. Okay, what's he saying here? He's saying, do not stop mentioning God just because your heart is not present. Forgetting him completely is worse than being inattentive while you're mentioning him. فَلَأَنَّ غَفْلَتَكَ عَنْ وُجُودِ ذِكْرِهِ أَشَدُّ مِنْ غَفْلَتِكَ فِي وُجُودِ ذِكْرِهِ. So if you are mentioning him and you are inattentive, that is better than not mentioning him at all. And then he's saying, فَعَسَىٰ أَنْ يَرْفَعَكَ, perhaps he will alleviate you from being inattentive to being attentive. من ذكر مع وجود غفلة إلى ذكر مع وجود يقظ. Perhaps he will wake up, and instead of just mentioning him and you are inattentive, to being attentive. And perhaps from being attentive to being present. So from just remembering the words and what they mean, to being present with Allah, again, in your heart, rather than presence in any physical sense. Of course, we're not talking physics here. And from being inattentive to being attentive. And from being attentive to being present. And from being present, from being fully absent from anything but him. وَمِنْ ذِكْرٍ مَعْ وَجُودِ حُضُورٍ إِلَى وَجُودِ ذِكْرٍ مَعْ وَجُودِ غَيْبَةٍ عَمَّا سُوَى الْمَذْكُورِ وَمَا ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ بِعَزِيزٍ. This is not difficult for God. He's saying it's not difficult for Allah to move you up the stairs of remembrance, of mentioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One step, basic step, is to mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even if you are inattentive. So, with your sibha and while you're talking, you're saying astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Fine. And then from that, he might move you from inattention to attention. To say, oh, astaghfirullah means this. And then from attention to presence, to really feel the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again in your heart. And you do this istighfar in a way that is very, very sincere and very feeling of the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then from being present to being absent from anything but him. That is another degree of awareness. It's not to go unconscious or anything, but basically to really be so absorbed to the extent that you feel nothing else. Again, mentioning the companions, mentioning the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some of the companions in their prayers used to be so from attention to presence and from presence to absence from everything, to the extent of really not hearing people. They call them and they don't hear. Abdullah ibn Zubair, it's a very famous story, when he was praying and his house fell down, the ceiling fell on the people in the other side of the hall. He was praying in a side, the ceiling did not fall on him, the ceiling fell on the people on the other side of the hall. And then it was screaming and this, a lot of scream, a lot of noise, and people, you know, collected, you know, whatever they can from the rubble. And then he finished his prayers and he said, did the house fall? When he saw the house. So they told him, you didn't see, you didn't hear. He said, no. So he was praying to the extent that he did not even hear the house falling. He did not hear the earthquake or whatever. Abdullah ibn Zubayr was famous for that, to the extent that the companions say that when he used to pray, the birds used to come and stand on him. They think he's a branch or something, or a tree. They would come and stand on his head because he does not move. So that kind of concentration, Abu Bakr and Umar and so on have different similar stories, that when they used to pray, they hear nobody calling them. Because it's not because they lose consciousness, but they are absent from anything but him. This is what the Shaykh is saying. The degree below that is to be present, you know, and ta'budu Allah ka'annaka tara, you know, as if you're seeing Allah. So there is a presence here. And the degree before that is attentiveness. Oh, so what am I saying? Oh, Jannah, oh, that's that. It's in the mind. And then presence is in the heart. And then the absence is in the consciousness, is in the higher level of consciousness. So he is saying that you need to continue with your dhikr, and you're not supposed to quit your dhikr. Next, he's talking about freedom. He's saying that the next step in the journey is freedom from humiliation, neediness, and illusion. He is saying, مَا بَسَقَتْ أَغْصَانُ ذُلٍ إِلَّا عَلَى بِذْرِ طَمَعٍ مَا بَسَقَتْ أَغْصَانُ ذُلٍ إِلَّا عَلَى بِذْرِ طَمَعٍ He's saying the tree of humiliation stems from a seed of neediness. A tree of humiliation stems from a seed of neediness. When you feel that you need the people, this is a seed that will grow to become a tree of humiliation. And he is defining freedom, and then he goes on, he's defining freedom in the Islamic sense. Freedom in the Islamic sense is slavery to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Freedom in the Islamic sense is to be enslaved by none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes. Haja. No, because tama' is an act of the heart. The neediness is an act of the heart. But need is an act of the body. You can have haja, but you don't have tama'. You see? So he is saying that if you have tama', if you have neediness, if you feel the need in your heart, I need you to give me food, for example. I'm hungry, that's why I'm thinking about food. So I need you to give me food. But I don't have this neediness. If you don't give me food, that is fine. I will survive. You see, so that's a difference between neediness in the heart and neediness in the body. So he is saying that the neediness of the heart would grow to become a whole tree of humiliation. مَا بَسَقَتْ أَغْصَانُ ذُلٍ إِلَّا عَلَى بِذْرِ طَمَعٍ مَا قَادَكَ مِثْلُ الْوَهْمِ Nothing deceives you as an illusion. Because you have an illusion that people will benefit you or harm you. And that creates the neediness in your heart for that people, for these people, because you think that they harm you or benefit you. And therefore you have this neediness in your heart. But if you don't think that they harm or benefit, and that the harm and the one who harms and the one who benefits is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will not have the neediness in your heart, and therefore you will not have humiliation dealing with them. Yes, of course, you can ask them. But the Prophet ﷺ, that's also the hadith, everything of this related to the hadith. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, سَلُوا الْحَاجَاتِ بِعِزِّ الْأَنْفُسِ. Ask people with pride. Ask people with self-confidence. Don't ask people with humiliation. You ask people with humiliation, then they are, you have an illusion that they benefit you or harm you. But you should ask them with pride. So go ask your boss for a raise. That is fine. But ask your boss with pride in your work or in your credits or whatever it is. Don't go and humiliate yourself in front of your boss so that your boss gives you money. That is the difference here. The work of the heart versus the work of the body. He's saying, أنت حر مما أنت عنه آيس وعبد لما أنت له طاعم. This is because you are free from what you give up on, and you are a slave of what you need. So if you have the stomach, then you are a slave. And you are a slave to somebody else but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you have the tama, you have the neediness in your heart. But if you give up on people, then you are free from them. And that is the definition of freedom in the Islamic sense. The definition of freedom is not self-ownership or whatever. The definition of freedom is that you are a slave of Allah, and everything else is also a slave of Allah. And that is how I'm free. Because I am not enslaved by anybody. Yes, I need people to give me things, but it is Allah who gives, for sure. And I need people to avoid harm and to take benefit, but it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who harms and the one who benefits. So if you have this in your heart, then you're free. And if you're free, you are free from the illusion that people will give you anything. And that is a very important step on the way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
By the way, there is an English saying, be the servant of Allah and not the servant of the servants.
Exactly, not the servant of the servants. And in fact, the same applies to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, مَا بَسَقَتْ أَغْصَانُ ذُلِّ إِلَّا عَلَى بِذْرِ طَمَعٍ. So if you have tama, if you have neediness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then not humiliation, humbleness in that sense. It would be an English, different English word. But then a dhul in Arabic means humiliation and humbleness. Dhul lillah is humbleness to Allah. But dhul linnas, humiliation of people. So if you have neediness, if you feel that you need Allah, then this will grow to be a tree of humbleness to Allah, a tree of servanthood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this has no illusion in that sense, because you are needy to Allah, the one who can give you and harm you and benefit you. And that is the right neediness. And therefore, then your neediness will be a step towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it's in the right direction, so it is neediness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's a step in the right direction. And if it is neediness to the people, then it's a step in the wrong direction. It is a step in the direction of slavery. And then he's talking, after freeing yourself from neediness, and Allah gives you blessings, you have to thank Allah for them. So thanking, that's a step forward. الشكر على النعم. He's saying, مَنْ لَمْ يَشْكُرْ النِّعَمْ فَقَدْ تَعَرَّضَ لِزَوَالِهَا. You risk losing your blessings when you don't thank him for them. And وَمَنْ شَكَرَهَا فَقَدْ قَيَّدَهَا بِعَقَالِهَا. And you tie them to you firmly when you thank him for them. So, لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. The verse that we all know. If you thank me, I'll give you more. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is promising as a law that if you thank him, your blessing will continue to be with you. But once you change your thanks to him into forgetfulness, or you are just saying, well, I deserve that anyway, or this is going to be there, you take your ni'mah for granted, you take your blessing for granted, then you start to risk losing your ni'mah, your blessing. But if you thank for the blessing, then you tie your blessing to you. And that is a law. It's in the Quran. The Quran is saying, لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you thank me, not just tie to you, I will give you more. Right? So وَمَنْ شَكَرَهَا فَقَدْ قَيَّدَهَا بِعَقَالِهَا. If you thank him, then you tie the blessing to you. وَمَنْ لَمْ يُقْبِلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ بِمُلَاطَفَاتِ الْإِحْسَانِ قُيِّدَ إِلَيْهِ بِسَلَاسِلِ الْإِمْتِحَانِ. And if you do not advance towards him by doing excellent deeds, he will pull you towards him with the chains of tests. So he is saying that now when he gives you that ni'mah, you thank him, you're doing excellent deeds, then you're on the right way. You don't, he will start to pull you towards him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the chains of tests. And that is a blessing too, because he wants you to be close to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you thank him, then you're close and you're fine and you preserve your ni'mah. And you continue thanking him, and he continues to preserve your ni'mah. But whenever you turn back and you don't thank him, then he will start to give you trials and tests. And these trials, you have to understand them properly. Because when he gives you a trial, he might be giving you the trial in order to make you closer to him, to draw you closer to him. And that's why he's giving you the trial. Or he might give you the good thing, and he's giving you the good thing in order for you to take it far away from him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the next, he's saying, وَرُبَّمَا أَعْطَاكَ فَمَنَعَكَ وَرُبَّمَا مَنَعَكَ فَأَعْطَاكَ. You might think that he's giving you, but he's depriving you. And you might think that he's depriving you, yet he is giving you. And often it happens that we think that something is the biggest gift that Allah gave me, and it turns out to be a disaster. The same thing that I thought is a gift, the same job or the same whatever it is, wealth or thing that I think that Allah is giving me as a gift, turns out to be a big trial. And it turns out to be a big test, the same gift. And sometimes I feel that what I'm facing is a test, and it's too much, and it's a problem, and I'm facing so many problems. And that very problem is a gift. That very test is actually a gift, because I came out of that test with whatever it is, with a good friend, or with a stronger body, or a stronger relationship with that person I'm having a problem with, or whatever it is that Allah could give you as a test, yet the outcome of that test is a gift. So he is saying you have to know that when you deal with this equation, رُبَّمَا أَعْطَاكَ فَمَنَعَكَ وَرُبَّمَا مَنَعَكَ فَأَعْطَاكَ. Perhaps he gives you, but he is actually depriving you. And perhaps he deprives you, but he is actually gifting you or giving you. Then he explains, إِنْ فَتَحَ لَكَ بَابَ الْفَهْمِ فِي الْمَنْعِ عَالَ الْمَنْعُ عَيْنَ الْعَطَاءِ. If he opens the doors of understanding for you, then the deprivation is a gift. The difference between the deprivation and the gift is your understanding of the deprivation or the gift. So if he opens the doors of understanding while giving you the deprivation, then this very deprivation is actually a gift. It is not a deprivation. And he gives a number of examples. رُبَّمَا فَتَحَ لَكَ بَابَ الطَّاعَةِ وَمَا فَتَحَ لَكَ بَابَ الْقَبُولِ. Maybe he opens, he might open the door of worship to you, but does not open the door of acceptance. You think that it is a gift that you pray Taraweeh every day, but he doesn't accept you Taraweeh. Why? Because your understanding was not up to the level of Taraweeh. Your understanding was you're praying in order to see your friends or for people to say, oh, he's prayed Taraweeh, or whatever it is, like whatever bad intention that you had. And that makes even the ibadah itself not a gift sometimes. So he opened a door for you to pray, but because your heart was not right and your understanding was not right, then the ibadah itself is a deprivation, because it's ended up being a sin. وَرُبَّمَا قَضَى عَلَيْكَ الذَّنْبَ فَكَانَ سَبَبًا فِي الْوُصُولِ. He might you might be destined to sin, but this becomes a means of ascension. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned about the man who made a sin. So for the rest of his life, he remembered his sin, and he اجتهد في العبادة, and he continued to be diligent in worship. And that sin ended up being a gift, because he entered Jannah because of that. Of course, this does not mean, again, a misunderstanding. It's to go and do sins so that you repent and enter Jannah. You know, some people say that, which is, I don't comprehend. But that is not the point. It's not the point. It's to go and make the sin so that you humble yourself, and that I saw some people doing that, and that is absolutely insane. That is not what Islam is saying when it talks about a sin that brings you to paradise, because it is a sin after the fact. You look back after the fact and you say, okay, I did that and that was wrong. Maybe I should fix myself. Maybe I have my faults. And then you go on with it. But after the fact, not before the sin, you think about sinning just to humble yourself and this kind of stuff. So basically he's saying, you might be destined to sin, but this becomes a mean of ascension. A sin that produces humbleness and need to Allah is better than an act of worship that produces arrogance and prejudice. And that is also a tricky thing to understand here. That in this case, because of your humbleness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and need, that sin becomes better than an act of worship where you are just acting to produce arrogance and pride and prejudice in that sense. So basically, no, you have to know what you are doing. So if it is a sin, then repentance and fixing yourself. And if it is an act of worship, then your proper receival of that should be that this act of worship should be for the good, for being closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he goes on to give other examples. وَإِذَا أَوْحَشَكَ مِنْ خَلْقِهِ فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ يُرِيدُ أَنْ يَفْتَحَ لَكَ بَابَ الْأُنْسِ بِهِ. And he's saying, if he takes you away from people, then know that he is opening to you the doors of his company. That is a deprivation, that is a gift that we don't often see. You find yourself all of a sudden away from everybody, traveling. And that is loneliness. But that loneliness, he is saying, he's opening to you the doors of his company. You're sitting by yourself in a hotel room, or in a hospital, or in a prison, or something like that. Then you find yourself in a prison, inshallah, in a political crime, not a serious crime. Now you find yourself in prison, that opens the doors of his company. Because when you are in prison, again, a political crime, then this makes you closer to him. It makes you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you are on a hospital bed by yourself, then whom are you going to mention? What are you going to say? You mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so forth. So he is saying that if you find yourself away from people, then know that he is opening the doors of his company. وَإِذَا أَوْحَشَكَ مِنْ خَلْقِهِ فَاعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ يُرِيدُ أَنْ يَفْتَحَ لَكَ بَابَ الْأُنْسِ بِهِ. And there is a hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, different narrations, but I think it's at least Hassan, where the Prophet ﷺ say, إِذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِعَبْدٍ خَيْرًا أَوْحَشَهُ مِنَ النَّاسِ. If Allah wants good for someone, he makes him away from people. He makes him isolated from people. So sometimes that isolation, not forever, of course, and not for every place and time, of course, temporary isolation, is something that is very good. You find yourself by yourself in an i'tikaf, or in a travel, or by yourself in a desert. That is something that will add to you, not take away from you. That is a gift and not a deprivation. So he is saying, if he opens the doors, if he takes you away from people, then he is opening to you the doors of his company. وَمَتَى أَطْلَقَ لِسَانَكَ بِالطَّلَبِ فَاعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ يُرِيدُ أَنْ يُعْطِيَكَ. And if he opens the doors of you to ask, then know that he is giving you something. Okay, why is he giving you the trial? It's for you to ask. He's giving you the test so that you pray. And when you pray, once you pray, know that he's going to give you something. وَلَقَدْ أَخَذْنَاهُ بِالْعَذَابِ فَمَسْتَكَانُوا رَبِّهِمْ وَمَا يَتَضَرَّعُونَ. We had inflicted them with torture, with some punishment, so that they surrender to Allah and they pray. التضرعون. تضرع is deep prayer, so that they fall in deep prayer. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes gives people, quote-unquote, torture, gives people a punishment, gives people a trial, so that they pray. That is the only wisdom. All you needed to do to get out of your trial is to really, sincerely close the room and go on your knees and pray and say, you know what, get me out of that. And he gets you out of that. And that is a blessing. That is a gift. That is a gift, not a deprivation. When he gives you a chance to pray sincerely, he opens the doors of prayers, then know that he's opening the doors of giving you something. And if he opens the doors of isolation, or he closes the doors of company of people, know that he is opening his door to you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, for his company. So you need, so all of this is under ربما أعطاك فمنعك وربما منعك فأعطاك. Maybe he gives you, and rahmukullah, maybe he gives you, but he's actually depriving you, and maybe he deprives you, but he's actually giving you, and you don't understand, he's saying. So therefore, under that, put everything, that anything that you think is a gift might be a trial, and everything that you think is a trial might be a gift. فأما الإنسان إذا ما ابتلاه ربه فأكرمه ونعمه فيقول ربي أكرمن. وأما إذا ما ابتلاه فقدر عليه رزقه فيقول ربي أهانن. When Allah gives the human with a luxuries, the human says, Allah honored me. And when Allah gives the human with limitation of his providence, Allah's not even taking everything, obviously. He takes one or two or five things. But he gives you billions of things anyway. But he takes one thing or five things, and you feel that's a total disaster. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, Kalla. No, this is not the correct understanding. The correct understanding is to do good deeds and to be kind to the orphans. And then when you do good deeds, you will start to put the trial and the gift in the right context. That something that is a trial, that you see as a trial, might be the gift that you are waiting for. And something that you see as a gift might be the trial that you need to deal with wisely. And therefore, not everything that appears to be a luxury in life is a gift. That's the Quran is saying, Surah Al-Fajr. And not everything that appears to be a trial is a test or a punishment. But this is not necessary. It might be the thing that opens the doors for you. And actually, this is tied as well to discovering your faults, because trials make you discover your faults, and that is a gift. So if I have a failure in my business, for example, and I discover how disorganized I am in my business, and then I become organized, and I plan very well, and then I become a very, very good businessman afterward, then this first failure in the business was actually a gift, because I discovered my faults, and then I went ahead. The same thing goes with anything.
But would you consider that as a sunshine in the beginning then?
Eh?
Would you consider that as sunshine in the beginning?
Sunshine. Your reaction could make the sunshine.
Yes.
It depends on your reaction. So that is why the Prophet ﷺ, thank you for reminding me, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٌ.
So,
I am amazed, he's saying, by the believer. Everything is good for him. إن أصابته سراء شكر فكان خيرا له وإن أصابته ضراء أصاب فكان خيرا له. If he sees a good thing, he is thankful and it's good for him. If he sees an evil thing, he is patient and it's good for him. So it's always good for him. If you are a believer, everything is good. Life is good, as you guys say in this country. If you are a believer, then everything is fine in that sense. But it depends on how you see it, how you look at it. And that is an act of the heart rather than the playing of the mind. And you need to really see the gift in the difficulty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, سَأَجْعَلُ اللَّهُ بَعْدَ عُسْرٍ يُسْرًا. Allah will bring ease after difficulty. So when you see a difficulty, then you know that ease is coming after. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is even saying, سَأَجْعَلُ إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. Not just بعد. Not ease comes after difficulty. Ease comes with difficulty. فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. Yeah, there is nothing in the Arabic language that could be more confirming than that. With difficulty comes ease, with difficulty. So sometimes when you have a difficulty, you need to sit back and what is the ease that's coming with this difficulty? Because with every difficulty, there is ease coming. There is something good that came with every bad news. If you think about it very well, you will see that even though this is awful news, within that awful news, there is something good that came.
Someone said that with difficulty comes ease, with ease comes difficulty. So I kept thinking that if you have an easy time, then you should look for a difficult time ahead. If you have a difficult time, you should look for an easy time ahead. Is this correct?
Sure. Well, if you have a difficult time, you look for the easy time ahead. That is true. But if you have an easy time, don't look to the difficult time ahead. In Islam, pessimism is not allowed, but optimism is. So you can see anything in the world to make you optimistic. That's Islamic. The Prophet ﷺ used to look for these coincidences and whatever in order to be optimistic. But he would not agree with the coincidences that make him pessimistic. So if you are in ease, don't look out for difficulty. You know, maybe you will be in ease all your life. Just thank Allah, you know. But if you are in, and it's not going to happen, difficulty will come, but it just, you never know. You never know. But if you are in difficulty, then look out for ease. That is true. Any other comment?
Yes, I just wanted to share that I truly was humble when Sheikh Waji once actually interpreted this ayah of Musha, Yusuf Yusuf. And his narration was that in the face of adversity, while you are faced with adversity, Allah will bless you with ease. And it's the test of iman that you are able to identify with ease, basically, because you could be so engulfed with the adversity that you overlook the ni'mah that Allah has given you at the same time.
Yeah.
So it's the simultaneous ease that is given in the face of adversity.
Yeah. Well, I agree. I totally agree with that.
That seems a little... that's a very difficult thing to accept. Seeing what bad things have happened, what evils and wars and massacres and etc., etc. Surely not everyone who's been crushed in all the disasters of humanity has reached some sort of high spiritual state and didn't deserve those calamities that happened to him in the first place. So this is a little too sugary, possibly. Possibly.
Well, it's a believer's life is sugary anyway. That's what we're talking about, the heart. I'm not talking about taking an action based on that. I'm talking about how the heart. You're talking about what, natural disasters, for example, when they happen.
That and human-made disasters, wars and
wars. Okay.
Massacres and.
Well, there is good in every. I don't know what. Which war you're talking about? Is it a
World
war?
World War II, a massive industrial modern war, for example.
Yeah, well, there is a disaster.
Casualties.
Yeah, well, there is a disaster in that. There is an invasion of a certain country by a superpower for oil, for example, or for whatever, strategic gains or whatever.
Just
okay,
to keep
sure.
The military in good form.
Just to keep the military in good form and weapons sellers, companies to be, you know, nice and rich and to make more billionaires in this world and so forth. Yeah, sure. Is there good in this? Well, there is. If you think about it, there is a lot of good. But I'm not saying that therefore they should go and invade the countries. I'm just saying that if I am in a position of being invaded, I should look at the good. One good that comes out of it is self-reflection and self-criticism. Because there is a, like when the powerful people invade the less powerful should ask themselves, why are we invaded? Like, why are we invaded? How come we're invaded? What's going on here? This particular city was the cream of the crop of civilizations at some point. Talking about Baghdad, for example. Okay, why is Baghdad in such a bad shape to the extent that doesn't have anybody to defend it? What is wrong with us? And that question was asked. I know it's a very painful question, but it's a very important question to ask. And therefore, we have to fix ourselves. I don't know if we fixed ourselves in Iraq anyway, but we didn't. It's still going down. But basically, what wrong did we do to the extent that our glorious leaders and glorious army and all of that are basically big mouths? They don't do anything. They talk in the media, and then the armies come, and nobody does anything. Everybody's running away. What's going on? And then, you know, The big leaders are, you know, picked out from holes and stuff and rat holes. What's going on here? So that's one serious question. Another and therefore that serious question will develop a lot of good in the sense of what are our problems? We have sectarian problems. We have weakness. We have this people who die like in a natural disaster or in a war are martyrs. You know what can you? We should think as humans rather than thinking as Allah, you know, or God. We are not God. We should not think in terms of why Allah did that, because I am not God, I don't know. Allah has a wisdom. Why a tsunami comes and kills 100,000 people. Allah has a wisdom. But I should think as the human who is either in that tsunami and I die, or I'm from that nation or outside and I see what's happening. There are bigger cycles in this world and this universe than what we can imagine. Maybe there is a greater, much, much greater good on a very, very different level that I'm not aware of, for this meteor to come and hit Earth and finish us all, or 90% of us. There is a greater cycle that maybe the 10% after 500,000 years will produce something really good. And that is the wisdom from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if I think in terms of Allah, I will have very strange logic that is not our human logic. But our human logic, okay, the survivors should be stronger, should try to survive. And the people who died, they went to a different world anyway. They have hopefully a better life. So it's a very difficult question to answer, but you always have to look for the good in the disasters, and especially if the disaster has something to do with other humans inflicting harm or pain on you, on what happened that is wrong in the balance here. And that is a very important way to self-critique yourself.
But these are also in sync with the Sunnah al-Amiyah that you mentioned last week, Sunnah al-Tawil with the Sunnah al-Tawil.
There are cycles that I cannot comprehend. There are cycles of these stars and moons and these meteors that hit the Earth once a year or once a 6 years. There are explosions in the sun that happen once every 11 years. There has to be a wisdom for these cycles. Mm-hmm. And that explosion in the sun has to be driving us towards a better good. That's my belief as a believer. So every time it blew the telex lines 100 years ago, well, perhaps that was good. Perhaps we would not have discovered the fax and the internet had the telex line 100 years ago not blow up by the sun solar system. Now they are saying the next cycle of the solar explosions will blow all our computers, and the American government is creating all of these redundant computers in the sensitive nodes. In the computer network. This is serious business. This is science. This is not just 2012 movie. This is a science.
that will be Colonel Powell's.
There could be a movie. Though.
That will be weapons of mass.
You never know.
That will be weapons of mass destruction in a tube which Colonel Powell showed to the whole world.
Yeah, sure.
Weapons of mass destruction.
Maybe when we lose all our computers and our networks, we start to think, well, you know what, the industry, maybe some philosopher 50 years down the road, after everything, after we go back to the Stone Age, will tell the people, you know what, guys, this industrial revolution was wrong because we exploited nature. That's perhaps why I'm fond of the film Avatar. You know? We exploited nature. We dealt in a very materialistic way with this world, and therefore the previous cycle of civilization that was led by the Europeans and then the Americans, that was not right. We should not repeat the mistakes of the Byzantines, the Americans. And we should, in the next cycle of civilization, we should be less materialistic and we should exploit nature less. And this is khair, this is good. So, I don't know, some big tsunami will come and take everybody. Oh, that's our age, what can we do? That's our life ended there. But perhaps the 10% who will survive will create a better earth. And we're all dying anyway, you see. It's not news. Yeah. So.
The Lorax is also a great social commentary on the environment. Since you like Avatar so much.
Yeah. Oh. So anyway, so yeah, et cetera, et cetera. I don't want to continue after our time, but basically, The likes of this discussion that we had today is something that we need, I think, for, again, balancing the fiqh that we have of the practical fiqh with the spiritual fiqh, so that we balance the prayers and the dua and the fasting and the janazas and whatever fiqh that we have on this side, practical side, with another fiqh that is also a very important fiqh that comes from the Sharia, Quran and Sunnah too, that teaches us how to deal with this with our hearts, with everything from the janazah to the wudu to the fasting to the hajj to the sadaqah to the dua to everything. But it's not just the fiqh of dua, raising my hand, making wudu, but also how to make dua so that it's accepted. It's not just the fiqh of janazah, the four takbirs, and this, and the certain things that we do for ghusl and all of that, no, but also how to think about death and afterlife and so forth. And I think that is the original message of tasawwuf, the original message of, if you wish, spirituality in Islam, or that part of the Islamic Sharia that we actually need to deal with too, and take care of. And just this few hours of discussion hopefully will open some doors of understanding in that particular area. And this all goes under the maqasid theme anyway that we discussed, maqasid al-sharia, the purposes of the sharia. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a purpose from teaching us these things so that we have a better heart too, not just a better soul and remember life and offspring and so on, hifd al-deen wa al-nasl wa al-mal wa al-ard, not just better wealth and better offspring and better this, but also a better heart, hifd al-qalb in that sense. It's not mentioned in the kulliyat, in the universals of usul. Scholars don't mention that, they mention it in other sciences. But this is also part of the usul that is very important that we also need to take care of.
Honor and heart.
No, these are two different things.
Not really.
No. Oh, yeah. That's for another discussion, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.
Okay, just before you go, just there's a request from Sister. You want to take a group picture for all the people who attended?
Yeah, sure. I'd love to.
So I would please request that.